Today we discuss God, God in Hinduism. Often when people discuss this topic, God in Hinduism, they'll say idea of God, concept of God, etc. This is wrong. Because it's not idea, it's not something thought out. It's not something that has been reasoned out. It's not something that comes through a brain wave. It's through realization. That's about the topic. Now, whenever we think of God, we think of religions. And whenever we think of religions in modern times, we think of all the quarrels, all the killings that are taking place everywhere. You think of religion and you think of Hinduism, you think of Christianity, you think of Islam, and you think of this religion and that religion, and you think how they are fighting amongst each other, trying to prove one's supremacy over each other. And more importantly, with the social media on, you see how people are taking to social media to prove that their religion is the best. Sometimes I go through these posts and I find them pretty interesting. More than interesting, I find them funny. Because people who are writing these things, not only that they don't have understanding of these finer issues, worse, they have not read any of the source books. And if at all they have read any of the source books, they have usually read them in translations. And translations can never convey the idea unless done properly. Or if there is a proper commentary, proper explanation, and that explanation has been translated, and there are added comments to that. So for example, let's take the case of Gita. If you simply translate the verses of Gita, it will be very difficult for anybody to understand what exactly Gita is trying to convey. But after every translation, if there is some annotation, if there are notes, then only you can get an idea of what exactly Gita is trying to tell. Just imagine this way, that in earlier times, that is 700-800 years ago, when Sanskrit was the official language of India, the cultured people knew Sanskrit and they had a good knowledge of Vedic literature. Even then, Acharya Shankar had to write a full commentary to bring out the meaning of Gita. That means, even if you are trained in a particular culture, you need commentary to understand Gita. Today, we are far removed from that language. We are terribly removed from that culture. How can we understand Gita? You can understand. If you want to understand, you have to go to a teacher who himself has learned through traditions, not through books. He has to have learned it from a teacher who is a link in the huge tradition that is coming from the past. But what you can do is, you can take up one verse or two verses or three verses, and you can ask some master to explain, and he will have to explain it in context. He will have to go back from where this verse has come, what exactly it signifies. Only then you can understand. So, now this is not about Hinduism, this is true of every religion. So people who are trying to condemn other religions, they have absolutely no idea about what they are talking. And people who are trying to say that their religion is great, even they do not know what they are talking about. And when they are talking about God and God's greatness and God's miracles and things like that, it sounds so naive. And people who have some scientific knowledge, who have grown up in the traditions of rationality, they find these things very pretty repulsive. And they find it so repulsive that they get completely put off from the ideas of religion and idea of God and things like that. But if somebody has the patience, goes deeper into the system and tries to understand what exactly all these things are about, things start becoming clear. We have been discussing Hinduism, origin of Hinduism and basics of Hinduism and scriptures of Hinduism, And through that we covered philosophy and other aspects of Hinduism. And while discussing all those things, some of these ideas came, how exactly God realization takes place and what exactly the sages mean when they say God. Just to recapitulate what we have been discussing, what we discussed earlier. Under normal conditions like me, you and all, we belong to the world of action. We like to act. If you find that young boys are playing a game and somebody is sitting outside the field, outside the fence, you wonder what might be wrong with him. The school teacher goes and asks, "Why aren't you playing?" Because one finds it odd. If everybody in a party is laughing, joking and talking, and there is somebody sitting silently, not talking to anybody, the host gets worried. The host thinks there might be something wrong with that person, goes and asks what exactly is wrong. That means it's natural for us to be a doer, and it is natural for us to be a talker. If you are not doing, if you are not into action, and if you are not talking, people will consider you weird. People will consider that something is wrong with you. Till there is action, until there is talking, one cannot be contemplative. Under normal conditions, it's fair enough for one to be worried about why a person is not taking part in games, not taking part into action, or why he is not talking. But for a philosopher, for a writer, for an artist, to get involved into action, to get involved into talks, to get involved into little chit-chats, is death. Contemplative persons don't socialize. A person who socializes is not a contemplative person. And if a person is not contemplative, it only means that he cannot do great things. Not possible for, just not possible for that person. So all great creations, whatever kind of great creation you can think of, it all comes through contemplation. And that contemplation, when it goes deeper, that means in contemplation also you are thinking about a few things. But when the number of things on which your mind is dwelling reduces, it is known as meditation. So first is action, there is talking, there is contemplation, and finally there is meditation. Meditation means when you are thinking of one single thought, whatever that single thought might be. Once a person goes deeper into meditation, and if he gets accustomed to meditating for long hours, usually we call him a spiritual aspirant, a sadhaka. And if he can get knowledge of the supreme reality, some reality that expresses before him, we call him a sage. We call him a siddha purush. Now, these kind of sages, all these sages, whether they belong to India or they belong to America or to Europe, wherever they might belong, we find one thing absolutely common, that excepting for one or few exceptions, which are known as sudden conversion. For example, there was this Saul. He was going to persecute the Christians. He suddenly had the vision of Jesus on his way to Damascus. And he got converted. And he became Saint Paul. So these are very rare things. Why it happens, how it happens, we really don't know about these things. But we know one thing, that in general, these sages have to go on meditating for many years before they can think that they have succeeded in controlling their impulses, and they have succeeded in controlling their mind, they have succeeded in controlling their actions. And it is then that their mind reveals certain facts about the Creator, the creation itself, and the created. It is then that we call these persons spiritual persons. Now it has become a very common thing, even for the younger generation, to say that I am spiritual, but I am not religious. They understand neither religion nor spirituality. Spirituality, to be spiritual, you have to be a meditative person, and you have to be meditating for 7 to 8 hours minimum a day for years. Only then you are a spiritual person. Till then you are not a spiritual person. And these youngsters who have grown up on a liberal dose of Facebook and WhatsApp and things like that, they come teach us that they are spiritual and they are not religious. So anyway, this is life. So the spiritual reality, and when we are talking about spiritual reality, we mean non-material existence. When we talk of non-material existence, it means there is matter. Matter has certain traits, certain characteristics. Matter is created. Matter can grow. Matter can decay. Matter can be annihilated. It can be destroyed. And most importantly, matter can be grasped by our five senses and the mind. The five senses of perception that we have through our eyes, through our nose, through one or more of these, matter can be grasped. And matter can also be grasped through mind, through thinking, through reasoning, and in dreams. God is a non-material, something non-material. That means it's neither born, it's neither destroyed, nor does it undergo any kind of change. But most importantly, God is someone who cannot be grasped by senses nor by mind. Naturally, you may wonder that if he cannot be grasped by mind, how do we know that he exists? Now, that's slightly difficult. It's something like, you know, someone who has tasted a particular dish, he knows what that dish is about. And when that person talks about that dish to people who have not tasted, it's so difficult for him to convey. Because, for example, someone who has a special liking for wine, and he tries to make somebody who has abstained from these things all his life, tries to talk about how wine tastes and what are the merits of drinking, that person will never understand. He cannot grasp. Not possible for him. Because we grasp something through different methods. One of them is comparison. You have experienced something, you have the knowledge of something. When a new thing comes, you just compare, and there are some oddities, you smoothen that out, and that knowledge enters your knowledge bank. In case of something about which you have no idea, absolutely no idea, and this is something which is not even remotely connected with it, you cannot be impressed with that idea. God is something like that. God being non-material, and since he cannot be understood through material terms, when we are talking about something, anything that we talk in this universe, we are comparing that with the existing matter. But when we are talking about God, not me, I mean the sages, they have experienced God and they try to tell us God is something like this. When they say God is something like this, so you know that famous adage that mom is trying to make a baby understand the moon. She says, just look there with a finger. Just look there. And the baby keeps on fixing the gaze at the finger. Because the baby knows only mom. And the baby thinks that this is moon. Something like that. Since we have no idea about what non-material thing means, we have no idea about what spirituality means. So when somebody talks about God, says that he is the supreme being, so naturally we conclude that he is something like a king, because king is royal, supreme. When somebody says that he is kind, he is just, we think of something like he is like father, who is kind and who is also just. God does not want any kind of transgression. We think that he is something like our father, who doesn't allow us any transgression. So any kind of metaphor that's used for God, we take those metaphors and try to understand things in our own way. So how do these sages themselves realize God? When we say that they see God, seeing God is not the right word, realizing God is the right word, because that realization is not really through mind. The simple example that we can say is, when somebody goes into dreamless state, deep sleep, very deep sleep, and that person is woken up, when he or she wakes up, says that, I can't recollect where I am, and I remember nothing. I was in deep sleep, I was completely lost, and I can just say that I was in a deep state of joy. I had such a nice sleep, I'm feeling so happy. So two things happen. First is, you say you enjoyed that sleep. People who are deprived of deep sleep, they even tend to go insane. First they develop depression, they have different kind of mental disturbances, and ultimately it can go bad, it can be very bad for their mental health. Deep sleep is the place, deep sleep is the state that we enjoy most, more than anything in this world. And another very important thing about deep sleep is that you don't remember anything. You just remember that you remember nothing. If we take this example, it has nothing to do with deep sleep. The deepest level of meditation where one is face to face with God, which is technically known as samadhi, not trance. Trance again is a wrong word. Trance is often used in English, but samadhi is not trance. In earlier literature, sometimes samadhi was translated as trance. Samadhi is not trance. Trance is when your mind is lost in a particular state. But that state is typically material, it's a worldly state. You are watching some beauty. Beauty is extremely material. And your mind becomes one with that beauty. That state is a material state. It is trance, it's not samadhi. Samadhi is exclusively when your mind goes away from the material existence. So, we mention that when a sage keeps on dwelling on a single thought about God, and his mind slowly becomes one with that thought, as it becomes one with that thought, slowly, slowly, that mind and that thought become one. In the case of trance, as we explained, or for example, when say we are watching a very absorbing movie, very, very absorbing movie, my mind becomes one with that absorbing movie. My mind has become one with that absorbing movie. And so difficult to distinguish between the movie and my mind. So difficult. But then that is a material state of mind. And there is a ethereal beauty, there is a beauty, and your mind becomes one with that beauty. It's slightly higher, but that's also material, it's trance. But when you have been thinking about God's qualities, God's compassion, God's love, and your mind becomes one with the reality of God, now, this is not something material. Why? Because people who go into that state, When they are back from that state, they repeatedly assert that there is nothing material about that state, about that knowledge, that experience and that joy. And often the terms used is bliss. It's a blissful state. So, when we read the biographies of these great masters from any religion, we find that all of them had some kind of realization in which they experienced this non-material spiritual reality. That is, they described that there is something, there is that reality from where the reality of this relative existence has come. And that absolute reality is beyond any kind of material existence, material form. And when we are talking about two realities like material and spiritual, we also need to understand that once a person experiences that spiritual reality, he is no more attracted towards anything in this world. And he is not scared of anything in this world. He is not scared of disease. He is not scared of death. He doesn't want anything. He is not afraid of losing anything. Jesus got crucified. He didn't even complain. Like, his whole being changes forever. This is as far as he himself is concerned. But more importantly, he gets a very special power. A very, very, very special power where, if he wants, he can change the very nature of people. If you look at the life of Jesus, how he changed the lives of his disciples, or Bhagavan Buddha or Sri Ramakrishna, you find how they changed. I mean, why they chose some people over some other, we don't know. But they did. And they have that tremendous power by which they can change the minds. They're the world teachers. The way a teacher can guide a student's mind towards some learning, these masters, they don't lead. They change the mind in such a way that the minds of their disciples also move away from the world forever. So when we look at these religions, we find that they do talk about these spiritual realities, but the names that they give are different. For example, in Judaism they call Jehovah, which technically means the supreme reality that cannot be named. Absolutely, that's the right expression. He cannot be named, because you can name only an object. God is no object, and hence cannot be named. And from there, Christians call them God, Muslims call them Allah. And interestingly, the Buddhists, they don't call it God, they call it a state. Just now we were discussing about dreamless state. This is that spiritual state where no duality exists, where there is no death, where there is no birth, there is no duality of any kind. That is that spiritual state. But you know, when it comes to Hinduism, it's amazing, because every other religion is founded more or less on the words of a single master, excepting for Judaism. In Judaism, there were quite a few masters, starting from Abraham down to Moses and others. There were many teachers, but their teachings did not vary much. But in Hinduism, there have been masters and masters and masters. And not a handful of masters, not even a bagful of masters, they are only masters. And that makes a religion actually a very interesting fact, because one thing that all these masters from every religion will tell, that supreme reality, call it by any name. And for our convenience sake, in this talk we call him God. That God is infinite. And infinite always means infinite. He cannot be limited by some name. We cannot say that he is only Brahma. We cannot say that he is only Vishnu. We cannot say that he is only God. Because we would be contradicting ourselves. The moment you say that infinite is Vishnu and Vishnu is infinite, we have contradicted ourselves. And if you go very technically, if we really go through technicality, the name Jehovah used by the Jews is actually a beautiful name, because it correctly explains that it is that God who cannot be named. God cannot be named. Similarly, when Buddhists say Nirvana, it's a state. Godhood, spiritual trip, is not a being, is not a person, it's a state. If you go through our Upanishads, and they're talking about God realization, it's about a state. But when that state is seen through that mind, what happens? Usually when somebody performs sadhana, usually I'm talking, whosoever that person be, he has heard about that God since his childhood or at some stage, either through family traditions or through some guru. And that sadhana, the spiritual practices, are carried out on the basis of what he has learned in, through family traditions, through his basic religion, or through his spiritual teacher. So, for example, if you come to Ramakrishna Mission and you say that you want to be initiated in spiritual traditions, the head here will give you a mantra of, say, Sri Ramakrishna. So now Sri Ramakrishna becomes God for you. But it is not this Sri Ramakrishna who was born at Kamarpukur in 1836 and died in Kolkata in 1886. It is the attributes of Sri Ramakrishna, the spiritual attributes of Sri Ramakrishna, bhava, the spiritual reality about Sri Ramakrishna, that one has to meditate upon. It's not the person. The form of Sri Ramakrishna makes it easy to meditate, but then that is not the ultimate reality. It is the bhava, it is the spiritual attributes that's important. So, when we can understand this very basic thing, that spiritual aspirant, he meditates on something which he learned through his family traditions or from his master and meditates on that. So till his mind is active in the final states of meditation, he will realize God in exactly that form. For example, Sri Ramakrishna, when he was doing his sadhana, he was a priest in the Kali temple, and for him Kali was the ultimate reality, Kali was the truth. And when he went deeper and deeper and deeper into that spiritual mood, he experienced pure consciousness in the form of Kali. And later, when he started doing sadhana of, say, Vishnu and Krishna and Sri Rama, he was having those kind of spiritual experiences, spiritual realization. It simply means that depending on how your mind is focused, the spiritual reality, the infinite, will kind of take up a mask and come before you. But that mask will not be covering the entire infinite. Just imagine, just think. Think of, here is this board. Just think of this place full of consciousness. Smoke-like, cloud-like, and amidst that cloud there is a face. That is what Rama is. That is what Krishna is. Behind that face lies the infinite consciousness. And then you say that you don't want that mask. You put another mask. It's all the same, because the infinite consciousness behind that mask is important. And what about if you remove that mask? It will remain the same. Sometimes, you know, like we have some sweets, say some chocolate-based sweets. So you take wafers and put chocolates inside it. Wafer is not important, chocolate is important. So you can make any shape out of those chocolates. And you can also have without any shape. The important thing would be chocolate. Important thing here is the infinite consciousness. And consciousness means consciousness, because it's not something related to our thought. It is pure consciousness, and pure consciousness will be all powerful. It can think, it can will, it can act. And its mere will is the execution. We people, when we think of something, when we want to do something, we will have to execute that, but not this pure consciousness. If it thinks, let there be light, and there will be light. Says, let there be creation, and there will be creation. It's all powerful. Actually, these things are slightly difficult to comprehend, particularly the first hearing. And when you hear it a second time, a third time, a conviction starts growing. But even that conviction is of no use till you realize it yourself. If we now go back to our Vedic times, like when we are discussing God in Hinduism. So, when we talk about God in Hinduism, we can very clearly see that there are certain sacred books that discuss God. First of them is the Veda. And those of you who have been following these talks very closely would remember that when we were discussing the Vedas, we had mentioned the attributes of God that we usually find in the Veda. The second one is the Upanishads. And they provide very important backdrop for our understanding of Godhood. From there we move over. The next set of literature that gives us ideas about God is Puran, the Puranas. And then we have Gita, which is small part of the Mahabharata. It kind of sums up all these ideas. So we can say that God in Hinduism, the reality of God as sages perceived, as sages realized, have been presented to us through these four classes of literature. The Vedas are the first, the Upanishads are the next, the Puranas are the third, and Gita is the last. But Gita is the last, not in the sense that it gives us some new idea, it just correlates all of them. So if somebody, when we are talking about Gita, it doesn't tell us something new. Just brings all them together, all of them together. What I have done here is just presenting an overview of the idea of God. What we discussed till now, that gives a very clear idea about how you do see God. Actually, we discussed what exactly God is, what God realization means, how the sages realize God. Now, we can just see how the Vedas have seen, how the Upanishads have seen, how Puranas describe them, and how Gita sums them up. When we were discussing the Vedas, and you will find the video on that on YouTube, we had mentioned certain special traits about Vedic gods, and here we will mention them just in brief. We are not going into details, because if you want to know in details about that, you have to watch that video. We did not repeat them. The most important thing about the Vedic gods was that usually they represented the power of nature, and it was not about ancestor worship. Because usually it said that most religions started with worship of the ancestors. The Vedas were different. In Vedas we did have ancestor worship, but then they were known as Pitri. They were different from the gods. The gods are more like forces of nature, and they are spiritualized. It's not nature worship. It's the forces of nature seen as divine. We discussed that. And these gods, they had human qualities, but most importantly, they had power and they had goodness about them. Later, ideas of God in Puran, etc., were highly influenced by how the Vedas had seen, because the Vedic sages were considered to be the greatest, and we still respect the Vedic sages as being the greatest. Even Sri Ramakrishna says that They were great. And they were totally dedicated to spirituality. And because they were totally dedicated to spirituality, we have to accept what they said. So we have gods like Indra and Mitra and Varuna, and we have Agni and others. So they kind of represent the power of nature. And there are spiritual beings who are controlling those powers. They have a human form. And they also have their particular kind of chariots, particular kind of animals on whom they ride, and or maybe birds. Usually they are good, they are just, they are loving, and they try to maintain the order of this universe. But we also have abstract deities that later on came to play a very important role. Abstract deity means, for example, there is forgiveness. Forgiveness is known as Kshama. And there is respect, known as Shraddha. So these things became goddess, these became attributes. Initially they were attributes of God, and those attributes of God also became God or goddesses. So Vishwakarma was something like that. And some of the great attributes, for example, there is dharma. Dharma is a quality, it's an attribute. And later we find that dharma himself becomes God and he is equated with Yamraj. So this is another special quality that we find in the Vedas. And just to cut it short, we find that whenever the Vedas are talking about these gods, they never lose sight of the idea of the infinite behind it. While discussing Vedic prayers, we discussed many prayers where Indra and Agni and others, they are being praised, and they are being prayed as if they are infinite. That is the most important thing. If you look at Greek gods are highly finite gods. Vedic gods, they appear finite, but they are not finite. They are being worshipped as the infinite. And soon these sages realize that you cannot have so many infinities. Indra is infinite, and Mitra is also finite, and Varuna is also finite. And that is when the famous, very famous Vedic mantra came, Ekam Sadvipra Bodha Badanti. The truth is one, sages call it variously. Because infinite is one. That same infinite is being addressed as Indra and Varuna and Agni and Mitra, and in our present day times as Vishnu, as Shiva, as Kartik, as in South they call Murugan. It's the same. It's not the person who is important, it's not the form that's important. It's the attributes. And you find that the most important attribute of all these gods whom we worship is infinity. There are gods which are finite. For example, we have goddesses that rule different diseases. In Bengal we have Shitala Mata, who is the goddess of pox, chicken pox and smallpox and like that. So she is not perceived as infinite. But when you talk of Lord Shiva, and when you talk of Lord Vishnu, when you talk of Krishna, when you talk of Rama, the first thing that any of these sages would say, and any of the sacred books about them would say, that they are infinite. And you cannot have so many infinite. You cannot have Ram and Krishna and Shiva. So they say that Ekam Sat Vipra Bodha. But it's same. It's my liking. It's my orientation. It's my mentality. We are not a military regime. It's not regimentation. If you belong to military corps, and if you are fighting on the Pakistan border, then the duty of every military person is to shoot the enemy. They have one ambition, they have one goal, their purpose is one, their training is one, everything is one. The God realization is not about regimentation. It's about my growth. Here I am important. When it comes to growth, the way two artists are never same, two singers are never same, two painters are never same. Similarly, it's a fact that two minds are never same. Neither in the field of education nor in the field of religion, if somebody wants to grow spiritually, and it's a very interesting thing, if you find that two spiritual seekers are talking about spiritual reality as same, there is something seriously wrong with their realization. Because these two minds being different, their spiritual realization will also be different. Excepting for when they are talking about that final state of nirvana, about which they cannot speak through words. When the words fail about that ultimate spiritual reality, that's a different thing, because they are saying that we cannot say anything. But when they are talking about the spiritual reality in the form of, say, Sri Ramakrishna, the spiritual realization of two persons will vary. Even if that be by very little, because God is not an object. And two minds are not perceiving that God through their senses and mind, so that this pen to each one of us here will appear as a pen. But God will not appear as same to any two persons. He cannot. If he appears, first thing that happens is God becomes an object. And we become more powerful than God because we can grasp it. Our mind is more powerful than this pen because my mind can grasp it. It has captured it. It has been captured and captivated by my mind. If God is also captured and captivated like this, then he becomes inferior to us. God cannot be like that. Anyway. One very important aspect of God that we find in the Vedas is that there is no monotheistic concept. Monotheistic means there is one God above all other gods. This concept which we find in Abrahamic family of religions, that is with Jews and Christianity and Islam and also in Zoroastrianism, this concept is not there with the Hindus. When they say that my East is Shiva, I am a worshipper of Shiva, he will not say that I do not accept the reality of Sri Rama or Krishna like that. He accepts them, says that my mentality fits more with Shiva. So monotheism, sometimes there are some verses occasionally in the Puranas where such kind of discussion is there. But then that is to actually highlight once a person's devotion towards his chosen deity. So there is a Shiva devotee. That person may say, my Shiva is greater than Vishnu and Brahma. By that he does not mean to say that I am a follower of monotheistic religion. What he means to say that, well, I don't care what Ram is and what Krishna is. My love is for Shiva and I am worshipper of Shiva and he is everything for me. In earlier times, not in modern times. The husband-wife relationship in India used to be very sacred, also in the West. Now, if a female was married to a person, for her, her husband was everything. Or even in today's world, you will see that for a mom, her child is the best, her child is cutest, her child is the sweetest, like that. She may admire someone else's child. But a mom's child is her child. She will never want any kind of replacement. It's something like that with God. Now, we have discussed some of these attributes of God and prayers to God that describe the nature and characteristics of God of the Vedic period in our earlier talks. Just one particular prayer or attribute which I really love a lot is where sages are describing God as Tvam Sri Tvam Pumanasi, O Lord, you yourself have become everything. You are the woman and you are the man. You are the child and you are the old. And you are the dying, you are the one tottering with a stick. Whatever is there in this world, you alone have become. These a few ideas from the Vedas that we discussed and certain things that we get from the Upanishads were ultimately to influence the Hindu psyche, Hindu religious psyche. I got here some verses both from the Upanishads and Gita and just one verse from the Purana to give an idea of how Hindus view God. Now, before we continue with this selection, let me say, God is perceived both as formless, as we discussed, when you go into the deepest level of samadhi, where your mind also merges in that state, this is known as formless aspect of God. And when there is a thin line of demarcation, that is, that I-ness continues, when you know that it's me, and there is that God. For example, something like the deep sleep, where you remember, oh, I enjoyed the deep sleep, but I remember nothing, it's slight. There is a thin, very thin covering that separates you from God. When God is perceived that way, that is known as God with form. The technical terms are nirgun nirakar and sagun sakar. That nirgun nirakar is formless God, and you cannot say that he has any attribute. He exists, is blissful, is pure consciousness. The moment mind intervenes, that very God, now he appears as God with attributes, God with qualities. He is the creator of the universe, he is the preserver of the universe, he is the destroyer of universe. He becomes all powerful. Ultimately, it is the pure consciousness which has all these qualities. But then, there is no mind to perceive those things, so it is known as formless. And later, with the Hindus, two very important things came. The first one was the concept of Trimurti, where Brahma was there, Vishnu was there, and Shiva is there. Sorry, Brahma is there, Vishnu is there, and Shiva is there. And it says that the same God, when he creates, is known as Brahma, when he preserves, is known as Vishnu, and when he destroys, is known as Shiva. With that also came the idea of Shakti. Shakti, the power of God. Because when God creates, he does not create directly as in other religions. The power of knowledge, the power to create, the power to destroy, everything is inherent in God by his mere will, because he doesn't have to act. If God has to act, he becomes a doer. The goodness of action and the wrong of the action will go to God. God does not create anything, just his mere will. That means, as far as creation is concerned, either you have to say that it is totally separate, has nothing to do with God. And ultimately, because it's God's will, because it is, everything is coming out of that consciousness, God alone has become everything. If God alone has become everything, then neither the good nor the bad of the universe can touch him. This is something very important, because see, in Semitic religions, in Islam and Christianity, often these charges are made against God. He created bad, he created evil, he created good persons. And sometimes a child is born who is blind, a child is born in a poor family. So we feel as if God has been partial. In Hinduism, there is no such issue. Things go on their own. He just willed after that things have been going on their own. Number one. Number two, whatever is there, God himself has become. As we say, Tum Sri Tum Pumanasi. It is God himself who has become the rich, God himself who has become the poor, God himself has become the healthy, God himself has become the unhealthy, the sick. These are very exalted ideas, and we will be discussing some of these, how we perceive. And see, these are not theories, these are not poetic expressions, these are the truth. If you people ever get a chance to read the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna, you will see how Sri Ramakrishna describes his own spiritual realizations, where he is seeing these things. He is actually seeing these things. Oh yes, God alone has become the noble, and God himself has become the wicked. And the so-called fallen woman, the prostitutes of Kolkata, seeing that divine mother, she herself has become those things. She herself is. These are very high states. Anyway, let's have a few words. How Prishatsi says that all these things, Hansa, Shuchisat, Vasu, Antarikchasat, Hota, Vedisat, Atithir, Duronasat, Nishata, Varsata, Ritsata, Vyomsat, Abja, Goja, Ritja, Adrija, Ritambhyat. This is from Kathopanishad, where he describes that all these things that you see, the sun that's moving, the space, the fire that's worshipped, the guest in the home, everything. Everything, he himself is everything. Now, when we talk about Upanishads, let's remember that Upanishads see ultimate reality as Brahman. Brahman means, just now we are talking about the formless. The formless is known as Brahma. In English, it's called Brahman. And that same Brahman is Atman. When that reality is within me, it's known as Atman, the Self. When that same reality is the ultimate reality, it's known as Brahman. This Brahman comes in two forms. One is formless, another is with form. Formless is known usually as Nirakar Brahma, and with form is known as Sagun Sakar Brahma. Upanishads talk about all these things. So we really don't know when they are talking about Atma, and when they are talking about Brahma, and when they are talking about Sakar Brahma. They are all mixed up. Because that's the ultimate reality, and later on Shankaracharya wrote a commentary on that, he is repeatedly asserting that Brahma is a Vasudeva, Brahma is Atma, Atma is Brahma, and Brahma is Vasudeva, is Krishna. Not everybody will agree to that. It doesn't matter. It does not matter. That's the ultimate reality. But I am not Krishna. My essence, that is bereft of my body, my mind, everything, that is pure Atman, and that pure Atman is Brahma. That is God. How? Says Agnir Yathaiko Bhuvanam Pravishto Rupam Rupam Pratirupo Bhavuva. There is fire, the universal fire. When it enters different things, it takes up different forms. In matchstick, fire is of one form. In firewood, it is of a different form. In bombs, it is of different form. But it is the same fire. Just like that, ekastata sarva bhutantaratma, that Lord is one single. And when it enters different bodies, it takes up different forms. So he appears as you, as her, as she. And he appears as Indra, and he appears as Agni, as Yama, and all those things. And how he behaves, he says, Suryo yatha sarva lokasya chakshur nalipate chakshusair bhaya dosi. There is that sun. Sun lights the entire world. It lights the good. It lights the bad. It lights the bad. That does not affect the sun. Sun remains sun. Its light goes everywhere. There is that, say, here is this tube light. Somebody might be reading sacred scriptures in this light. Somebody might be reading dirty novels. Somebody might be indulging in dirty acts in this light. It does not affect the purity of light. Light continues to be light. Just like that, God is not affected by the evils of this world. It's because it's pure consciousness. In His presence, all these things are going on. But those going on do not affect God. The example that Sri Ramakrishna used beautifully was, there is this snake. Snake has poison. The poison affects others. The poison does not affect God Himself. Just like that. He's talking there about Maya. But something similar happens. There is good. That good does not come to God. There is bad. That bad does not come to God. And in Kathopanishad itself, we come across another beautiful verse. It says, Nityo Anityanam Chetnas Chetnanam Eko Bahu Nam Yo Vidhati Kaman. What is God? He is eternal amidst non-eternal. And He is the pure consciousness amidst all thinking process. We have thinking process, and often we think that thinking process is consciousness. But no, consciousness is not thinking process. Consciousness is the substratum on which the thinking process continues. Eko Bahunam, He is the one. And He becomes the many. Is that one who appears as many? And you are Vidadhati Kaman. Is that pure consciousness that fulfills the wishes and desires of all? tamatmastam ye anupashyanti dhira. These great sages realize him. And once the sages realize, they get the supreme peace. Because then they know the truth. They know that all this world apparently moves on power, on thoughts. But no, the real power, the real thinking lies somewhere else. And that God, he has set the world order. Everything is moving according to his wish. Nothing can disobey, nothing. No one can disobey that Lord Supreme Power. Just see how in the earlier verse is talking about the total aloofness of God. And from there it comes, Bhayat asya agnittapati, bhayat tapati surya, bhayat indrascha vayuscha mrityur dhavati panchama. The powerful ones, there is that sun, and there is that Indra, there is that fire, there is the wind god, and there is god of death. They all are scared of that supreme Lord, because he being there, all of them have to follow the dictates. Dictates means there is this world order, nobody can transgress that world order. That means everything is meant for good, as we shall see. No, it's not that. And where that God lives? Brahma Vedam Amritam Purastat Brahma Pashat Brahma Dakshinat Jad Dakshinata Cha Uttarena. That Brahman is in the east, is in the west, is in the north, is in the south, he is above, he is below. Alas Shodvam Cha Prasitam Brahma Vedam Vishwam Midam Varistam. Everywhere is God. God. Brahman. Nothing is outside him. So all these ideas give how God pervades everything, and the popular concept is God protects the good, God is meant for good, God is meant for order, etc., etc. We have selected a few verses from Gita also to give an idea. It says, Matta parataram nanyat kinchidasti dhananjaya. There is nothing greater than me, O Arjuna. Or mai sarvamidam prudam sutre maniganaiva. If you think of a necklace, in the necklace there might be different pearls, but the thread that goes through them is the same. I am that thread that runs through everything. Everything here is like that, like those pearls woven in a necklace. I am that thread. In what form? Raso amap sukompeya prabhasmi shashi suryeho. In every liquid, I am that rasa, the taste that comes through. For example, there is this water. When we drink, our thirst gets slaked. I am that rasa that slakes the thirst. And here is the sun and the moon. And the light of the sun and moon, it's me. Parava sarva vedeshu. Of all the Vedas, I am Om. Like that. Tribhi Urgun Mai Bhavai Sarvamidam Evi Sarvamidam Jagat Mohitam Nabi Janati Mamepya Paramavyam. This entire world is composed of three gunas, Sattva Rajatama. We had mentioned this while when we were discussing Sankhya. So people, they are deluded in this world, and that's why they cannot know me. Particularly when it comes to incarnation of God, people cannot know him simply because of that. God is knower of him, everything. Nobody can know God the way we understand. Vedaham samtitani vartamanani cha arjuna bhavishyani cha bhutani mantu vedana kashyana. I am pure consciousness. I know everything. I know the past. I know the future. I know the present. I know everything. But nobody can know me. Obviously, because mind and thoughts, they are inferior to that pure consciousness. That pure consciousness knows everything. The mind cannot know that pure consciousness. Every function of this world runs on the wishes of God. We just now mentioned from Kathopanishad how even the gods, they have to follow the dictates of the Supreme Lord, who is Brahman. And in our body also, all the bodily function, the breath goes inside and the breath goes outside and the food is digested and our metabolism carries on. Everything is carried on because the Lord is there. Ang vaishwa naro bhutva praninam deham ashrita pranapana samayukta pachamyannam chaturvidham. The way we have five senses, the sages have divided the working of vital forces within us into five. Says that God alone is those five forces that work within a body. And all the bodily functions, whether it be outside or inside, are carried out by these vital forces. And Lord alone has become all those. And the fire in the belly, we know that the acid secreted by our belly digests our food. Yes, the fire that is there, that is God Himself. So it's not God Himself. Like, they are trying to say that there is nothing outside God in this universe. Sarvasya chaham hridi sannivishto. God says, He is inside the heart of everybody. Matta smritir jnanam apohanam cha. Now there is a very beautiful line where it says that all the memory that stays and all the knowledge that comes, it comes through me. Most importantly, vipohanam cha, the forgetfulness, that also is me. Because if we don't forget things, we will not be able to move forward. There is pain. Unless we forget that pain, we cannot move forward. God is that pain too. He is the knowledge. He is the power to retain memories. And He is also the power to forget. Vedaishya sarvai rameva vedyo vedant krit ved videva chaham. So all these Vedas, they talk of that God only. All this nature works because God is there. He is that Supreme Lord under whose supervision all these things keep working. And He is the Father of the universe. He is the Mother of the universe. He is also the grandfather and great-grandfather of the universe. When we discuss Gita, we shall be discussing each of these verses more elaborately. And He is the supreme reality. He is the supreme authority. But most importantly, He is the supreme refuge. Whenever we need shelter, we go to this person, we go to that person, we go to this powerful person, we go to that powerful. And we forget that God is the ultimate refuge. He is the ultimate shelter. Whatever is created through Him. Whatever is destroyed through Him. Aham Atma Gudakesha Sarva Bhutashaya Hastita. I am that soul, I am that Atma that resides in the heart of everybody. How? Adityanam Ang Vishnur Jyotisham Ravi Angshuman. All that is good anywhere, that's me. Amongst the gods, I am Vishnu. And of all the lighted beings that we see from this earth, I am the sun, is the best. So, He is also in the Vishas, amongst the Naga, the great snakes, Anant is considered to be the best. And amongst the Daitya, who are antagonistic to gods, He is Prahlad. And amongst the birds, He is that vulture. Amongst the animals, He is the lion, He is the best. And amongst cheating, He is gambling. So it's not that God is only good. Wherever there is evil, that is also God. That also belongs to God. It's so difficult to understand. Dyutam chalayatam asmi. Amongst all kinds of cheating, the best is gambling. I am that. So, God is good. And all that is bad is evil. That is also God's. Life is of God. Death is also of God. And in sums up, yad vibhuti mat sattvam shrimat urjitameva. Wherever you find certain kind of power, know that it's me present there. If you find a great football player, you know that God's power is manifested there. There is a great cricket player, God's power is manifested there. This is a great film actor. God's special power is manifested there. And says, Atva bahunaitena king jatena tavarjuna vishtabhyamaham idam krishnam ekangshena sthito jagat. I am the supreme. And in a very small part of me is this entire visible, invisible universe. I am the supreme. And then one very interesting aspect of God we find in Gita in 11th chapter, when Lord shows Arjuna, Lord reveals himself to Arjuna in his Avishwarupa Darshan, that form. And Arjuna is seeing that how all the divine beings are praying to that Shri Krishna who is in the form of Vishnu. He is all kindness. The universe exists in him. He has many mouths. He has many stomachs. At the same time, Arjuna sees that all these warriors who have assembled there for war are entering his mouth as if rivers are entering an ocean. And that Lord, he has caught hold of those warriors in his mouth and is chewing them. And heads of those warriors are all crushed and the flesh of their body is sticking between his teeth. That's a terrible form. The same God who is good, that same God is terrible too. And when Sri Krishna, Arjuna asks, O God, who are you? Kalosmi lokshaya krita pravidho. I am Kal, I am death. And I become huge to destroy this universe. God is not only the creating power, He is not only good. The terrible too is only His form, because it's only through destruction that a new creation comes. To create something new, something has to be destroyed. God is the creator, but before that creation, He has to destroy. And one of the famous verses in Gita is, Maya Veta Nita Purvameva Nimitta Matram Bhava Savya Sachin. God alone does everything. Arjuna, you get up and you fight. I alone have done everything. Because ultimately, you know, we crossed one verse which says that I know the past, I know the future, I know the present. God alone is the doer. And we are just instruments in the hands of the Lord. So, in Bhagavatam also, the same idea is a very famous four verses in Srimad Bhagavatam, where Aham eva asam eva gre. Lord says that in the beginning, I alone was there, nothing else was there. That's why you cannot say that whether He existed or He did not exist, because there was nobody to perceive Him. That's why it's known as Advaita. There was nothing but myself. There was no material nature, of course, because there was nothing. And what you are seeing, O Brahma, Vishnu is telling Brahma, that also is me alone. And after all this creation is dissolved, only I will remain, nothing else will remain. And anything that has any substance in it, that is, which is seen as real by people, it is all me. And anything that doesn't have of no value, those things do not exist. That means whatever is there, it's God, God alone there. And it's my power that makes all these things appear. In Gita also, the same feeling, that is power of God that manifests at the universe. So, these ideas says that a person who is searching after the absolute truth has to go on aspiring for me directly or indirectly. Because God is the ultimate shelter, is the ultimate truth. So in brief, we can say that God is that supreme reality which has absolutely no relation to material reality in any form, in absolutely any form. He is formless, but when perceived through mind by spiritual aspirants, he is also known to have form. He is not into miracle mongering as we normally understand. The popular belief that when we pray to him and we offer things and he will answer. No, we don't get such ideas. Not in the Vedas. It's more of, you love God. You love God because that is your nature. That is your true self. Here we have covered the idea, this God in Hinduism in very brief. When we take up each of these scriptures, maybe next year, we will be discussing these things in more detail. But bottom line is that God is perceived as the supreme reality, as the spiritual reality, and popularly in Hinduism is seen as Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva. With that, there is that idea of Shakti, Mother, who appears as, say, Durga, Kali, etc. And there is another important concept of incarnation that we will try to take up in the next talk.